Is it weird if I drink a smoothie while filming? Hello everyone, it's Emma. Today, I thought that I would film a little bit about being an Enneagram Type 1. Now, if you don't know what the Enneagram is, it is a personality test where you kind of get like sorted into different personality types, 1 through 9. I will put a bunch more information on it down below because I don't want to go into too much detail on explaining the Enneagram as a whole in this video. I specifically wanted to talk about my Enneagram type, which is the Type 1, or otherwise known as the Perfectionist, or the Reformer if we're being a little bit nicer. So like I said, if you want to know more about the Enneagram in general, I will link some things down below. I learned pretty much everything I know about the Enneagram from this book. It is called The Road Back to You, and it's written by Anne Morgan Cron and Suzanne Stabile, and they actually also have a podcast, which is also called The Road Back to You, which I will link both of those things down below. So the other day, I was rereading the chapter on Type 1 Enneagrams in this book, and it just made me think that I would like to make a video about it, chat a little bit about like my experience as a Type 1, and maybe give some advice for those of you who are also Type 1s. To start off, I wrote down two quotes about being an Enneagram 1. The first is from the song by Sleeping at Last called Atlas 1. They did a song per each Enneagram type. And when I listened to the one for Type 1s, I legit, like, almost cried. I just felt so known and understood. So one of the quotes from that song says, "Spend my whole life searching desperately to find out grace requires nothing of me." And then the other quote is from The Road Back to You, and it says, Type 1s need to be perfect. They chase perfection because they have this vague, unsettling feeling that if they make a mistake, someone is going to jump out to blame or criticize or punish them. So one of the things about Enneagram 1s is that we have this constant pressure on ourselves to be perfect. This plays out differently for different Type 1s, but mostly I'm going to talk about what it's like for me. Each type, they kind of give a typical Achilles heel or deadly sin, whatever you want to call it. And for Type 1s, it's anger. But Type 1s also see anger as the number one emotion that good people should not express. And 1's entire driving thing is a fear of being bad or corrupt, viewing everything very much as a right or wrong, black and white, I have to stay good at all times. However, Type 1s, because of that really strong perfectionist drive, we do have anger when we see all the imperfections in the world. For me, this mostly is towards myself, seeing imperfections in myself, but the more aware that I become of my personality, the more I have in fact noticed that I often get pissed off about the stupidest little things. Type 1s feel like it is necessary to do what is right, or what is responsible, or what should be done. And when we see other people who are able to let go and have fun and not put that such intense high pressure on themselves, we kind of get angry or feel resentful. I say this not in that, like, that's always my reaction, I have no control over it. I'm just explaining, like, the natural bend of a Type 1. Later, I will talk more about what I choose to go with or how I combat these things, because obviously I don't walk around judging everyone and being like, oh, it's fine, I'm a Type 1. For example, if someone like forgets to do something, like if I asked someone to do something and they just kind of forget, like it slips their mind, to me, my immediate reaction is like, how? Like, how would that happen? There's no way that I would ever just like forget. So it must be that they on purpose forget. Because I put such a high standard on myself, it's sometimes difficult to process the fact that other people don't function in the same way and they don't put themselves to that extreme standard. And they shouldn't. Ones hold themselves to such a high standard that it can actually be really difficult to be loving and forgiving and understanding towards other people who don't do that for themselves. For example, if a person has a habit of like ignoring their issues and suppressing things and not really working through their emotions and letting things build up and bubble over and cause all kinds of problems in their life, I can get so upset about that. Does it directly affect me in my life? No, not at all. But seeing someone else who doesn't hold themselves to that standard that I hold myself to of constantly trying to improve and constantly trying to be good, it can just build up resentment. Not that I want it to, not that I let it do that. It sounds so annoying even when I talk about it. Like when I talk about being a Type 1, I'm like, wow, I must just be such an annoying person. But I think that that is what it's like when you look into the Enneagram and you kind of read about like the extreme of each type, because each type has healthy levels and healthy attributes and not healthy levels and not healthy characteristics. So when I'm talking about these kind of like what it's like to be a type 1, I don't mean that I walk around in the world just like letting my personality be on cruise control, because that would not go well for me, my personal happiness, or for my relationships. But yeah, I'll talk a little bit more about that later. One of the things about the Enneagram is it highlights and explains how everyone sees the world differently. So when ones walk around through the world, we see all the imperfections and all the things that could be improved upon. A quote that I really appreciated from the book, The Road Back to You, said, "We can't change the way we see, only what we do with what we see." So some ones only apply this kind of perfectionism to one area of their life, like always having the lawn be clean or always having their appearance be perfect, their grades, work, etc. Others apply it to everything. And I'm of the latter category. If I'm kind of functioning without checking myself, I very much hold myself to the highest standard in every area of my life. Put a lot of pressure on myself to be the best at everything, to be constantly improving and constantly making all the right decisions. You can kind of see how this would hold me back, because not everything is a right and wrong kind of situation. So it's definitely something that I've had to learn how to check and not just let run wild in myself. One of the most important things I think to know about type 1s is that they have a constant inner critic in their head, critiquing everything that they do. Everybody has that inner critic, but a type 1's never goes to sleep. An example of this is like if I go into a social situation, I'll go in, have a blast, be like having fun, and then get home and immediately run through everything I said and did to see if there was anything that I could do better or anything that I did that I think was like wrong, the wrong choice or whatever. Before I knew how to work with that and how to kind of quiet down that inner critic's voice, it was excruciating. I literally didn't even know that not everyone dealt with that until I got into the Enneagram and I started reading about type 1s, and I was like, oh, not everyone is like that. That's just me and other type 1s. The other thing that I didn't realize is that that inner critic's voice can be ignored and is not always giving me the best advice. Not always looking out for my success or for what is necessarily good, because it is good to be a flawed person. We are all flawed people. It's literally impossible not to be. I was reading through the lyrics to the song "Uhgood" by RM, and I really, really related to them as a type 1. This is what they say. "At times, I'm disappointed with myself. Honestly, I trample myself. Do you only amount to this? Need to do so much better. You need to be so much cooler. You have to win. You. To be out of place, it hurts so much. If you don't experience it, you cannot be known. My ideal and what is reality, they're so far, far away. But I still want to cross that two bridges to reach myself. To reach myself to the real me. All I need is me. I know. But why do I feel lonely? I feel so lonely when I'm with me." When I first read the lyrics to that song, I was like, this is like a type 1 anthem. Because that kind of way of talking, of like seeing your reality, seeing the potential, and trying to like cross the bridge to make the two meet, to make it so that I'm the better me that I want to be, the other kind of me that I see. Oh, I'm rhyming. I didn't mean to do that. That is very much what it feels like to be a type 1. I think a lot of what I have said up until this point has been like the natural kind of way that type 1s are, but I do want to talk a little bit about the positives of being a type 1. Because like any personality, there are going to be things you need to work with, and there are going to be things that are inherently your strengths. Your strengths are actually always the same as your weaknesses, so being a perfectionist is a strength and a weakness at the same time. Perfectionism can keep you from doing anything, and it can also help you to do a lot. One of the things that is great about being a type 1, and this obviously depends on how healthy you are, but if you are always shooting for perfection, when you fall short of perfection, you still have something done in excellence. So if I'm always pushing for something to be better and better and better, I'm going to make something really, really good, as long as I'm not too caught up in like that impossible kind of perfectionist mindset. And that means that I do tend to succeed in most areas of my life. Like, people often ask how I am so aesthetic. And honestly, I think it's because I'm a type 1. It just is a part of my personality. I notice all these tiny little details that a lot of people don't also notice. And I make those tiny details beautiful whenever I can. And when you kind of see all the little details and make each little detail beautiful, it adds up to one picture that is very beautiful. Ones also tend to fix problems. Ones who are functioning in a healthy state are usually advocates. They're usually working to end injustice in the world. We care about other people's problems because we care about things that are wrong. You can see how that kind of anger of seeing something that is unjust and wanting to correct it would actually be a really good thing if you're involved in some kind of social justice or a cause like that. We are also very orderly and organized. I do tend to be pretty productive because I'm good at ordering my life, at knowing like I should do this thing first, then do this thing, then do this thing. Setting things up as like first groceries, second filming, third go have fun or whatever. I tend to like see all the pieces and see all the steps that need to be done and then know how to like order them and keep my life orderly so that it moves at a faster pace. Marie Kondo, for example, is almost positively a type one. Now, kind of the key for type ones with combating that perfectionism, in my opinion, is vulnerability. Letting go of the idea that we need to be in control at all times or all hell will break loose, because it's just not true. One, it's impossible. You can't be in control of everything or of much, to be honest. And then also just allowing yourself to be seen as human and to be seen as flawed. It's what scares us, but it's also the key to not getting too trapped up in that perfectionist mindset. Friendships and deep relationships are so important to me as a type one because they emphasize that kind of vulnerability that I really need. And honestly, I think that is true of every personality type, not just type ones, but without those warm friendships and relationships, I have the capacity to be a highly judgmental snowman. If you are a type one, remember to let go. Have some fun. The whole world does not rely on you. Even your own whole world does not rely on you. Be sure to let others hold you up and do one wild thing every day. One thing that is not planned, one thing that causes you to just like forget your inner critic's voice and just go do something. Being good does not equal being perfect. I think that is key for a type one. Being good does not equal being perfect, and being perfect does not equal being lovable. It has also been so helpful for me to remember that there are multiple ways to like live well. There are multiple personality types, as the Enneagram emphasizes, and so when I see other people living in a different way or living with a different standard, it doesn't mean that they're also not living well. Each person has their own personality and their own beliefs, and it's good that way because we complement each other, and if we were all the same personality type, the world would implode because like too many type ones in the world would be real bad. It's good that it's that way, that everyone has a different personality, because it gives us all the freedom to move through the world in our own way and to make differences, and seeing the differences and accepting the differences in other people is very important for kindness and love. I actually really value people of different personality types in my life, like the sevens and the threes that I have in my life. I just value them a lot. Each person who is around me that is different from me has something positive to share, and seeing the differences in other people and seeing that like differences are good and I can even learn from them and take on some of the traits that they have and learn how to let go and not be so perfectionist is super, super important, and I appreciate it very much. So I think that's all I'm gonna say for this video. This wasn't really an overview of like the technical stuff with Enneagram because I didn't really want to talk about that, which is why I said I will link some stuff down below. I just wanted to talk about more of what it's like for me personally as a type one. I know that some of you guys are type ones and you wanted to hear some like advice or just some insight on what it's been like for me, so I thought that I would just share a little bit, almost like a journal entry. Honestly, the notes for this video were a journal entry. I hope that you guys enjoyed. Feel free to start up any kind of conversation in the comments of this video about the Enneagram or being a type 1 or being a different type. I'd love to chat with you guys as always. I hope that you are having a lovely day or night or afternoon, wherever you are, whatever you are doing, and I will see you in my next video.